The main structures shown in this specimen are the pancreas, the spleen, left kidney, left suprarenal, right kidney, right suprarenal gland, the duodenum, abdominal aorta, inferior vena cava, and that is the gallbladder. Now going into details, this is the pancreas. It has the head and the uncinate process within the C shape of the duodenum. Then the neck, the body of the pancreas, and the tail of the pancreas. Within the pancreas, you can see the major pancreatic duct. The major pancreatic duct unites with the bile duct within the head of the pancreas, and they will form the ampulla of Vater. The ampulla opens into the major duodenal papilla. The major duodenal papilla is surrounded by a thickening of smooth muscle fibers called sphincter of Oddi. The major duodenal papilla is located midway in the second part of the duodenum and is located posteromedial in the second part of the duodenum. The accessory pancreatic duct is not always present. When present, it opens separately on the minor duodenal papilla in the second part of the duodenum proximal to the major. That is the minor duodenal papilla. The spleen has a visceral surface and a diaphragmatic surface. The visceral surface of the spleen is partly related to the kidney, the left kidney. This impression here on the visceral surface is related to the left colic flexure or the splenic flexure of the large intestine. And the impression here is related to the stomach, so it is the gastric impression. The spleen is characterized by a superior border that is notched, and here you can find the notch of the spleen. When the spleen enlarges about 3 times its normal size, the splenic notch can be palpated beneath the left costal margin. At the hilum of the spleen, the structures that can be seen here are the splenic artery, the splenic vein, and the tail of the pancreas. These 3 structures approach the spleen through the lieno-renal ligament, which extends between the left kidney and the hilum of the spleen. Returning back to the duodenum, this is the first part of the duodenum. It is horizontal. It is located at the level of L1 vertebra. The second part of the duodenum is vertical, extends from the level of L1 to the level of L3 vertebra, where the third part of the duodenum continues horizontally and then ascends up a little till the level of L2 vertebra, where the duodeno-jejunal junction is located. And here, this is the beginning of the jejunum. The jejunum can be differentiated from the duodenum by the fact that the latter, that's to say the jejunum, has mesentery, while most of the duodenum is retroperitoneal in relation. The mesentery of the small intestine crosses the third part of the duodenum obliquely, and as it crosses the third part of the duodenum, the mesentery receives the superior mesenteric artery and the superior mesenteric vein. The superior mesenteric artery arises from the abdominal aorta at the level of L1, that's to say at the transpyloric plane, behind the neck of the pancreas. Above the pancreas, you can see this branch from the abdominal aorta, that is the celiac trunk. And the celiac trunk has 3 main branches. 2 of them are apparent here. The splenic artery, which is characterized by its tortuous course and passes along the superior border of the pancreas, although it's called the splenic artery, but it also provides the major blood supply of the body and tail of the pancreas. The other branch of the celiac trunk that is shown here is the hepatic artery. This is the common hepatic artery. It gives rise to the gastroduodenal artery and then right gastric artery. And now it is called the hepatic artery proper. The hepatic artery proper divides into left hepatic artery and the right hepatic artery. The right hepatic artery provides the cystic artery. That's to say the artery that supplies the gallbladder. The gastroduodenal artery, as you can see it here, passes behind the first part of the duodenum. And it is the artery that might be perforated if there is a perforated duodenal ulcer in the first part of the duodenum. The hepatic artery, bile duct, and portal vein, which is located behind, these three structures form the portal triad, and they are located in the free border of the lesser omentum. The hepatic artery on the left side, the bile duct on the right side, and behind them is the portal vein. The gallbladder has a fundus that is related to the transverse colon, a body that is related to the first part of the duodenum, and it has a neck that leads into the cystic duct. The cystic duct joins the common hepatic duct. The common hepatic duct is formed by the left hepatic and right hepatic ducts. So left hepatic, right hepatic duct form the common hepatic duct, join the cystic duct, and form the bile duct. The bile duct passes, the first part of the bile duct is located in the free border of the lesser omentum, then passes behind the first part of the duodenum, behind and within the head of the pancreas, where it joins the major pancreatic duct to open into the major duodenal papilla. This is the region of the triangle of Calot, Calot's triangle. It is formed by the cystic duct, common hepatic duct, and superiorly is the inferior border of the liver. The liver, of course, here is not shown, but this is the side which is formed by the inferior border of the liver. So this is the region of the triangle. Again, I repeat, the cystic duct and the common hepatic duct. The importance of this triangle is that it contains the cystic artery. And here is the cystic artery within this triangle. Of course, this is not the sole content of the triangle. The triangle also contains a lymph node in addition to the cystic artery. The space here behind the portal triad, where the portal triad is separated from the inferior vena cava, the space here represents the epiploic foramen. That is the foramen that communicates between the lesser sac and the greater sac of peritoneum. This is a posterior view of the same specimen. Again, you can see the C shape of the duodenum, and within the C shape is the head of the pancreas. Within the head of the pancreas is the bile duct. And here is the region of the neck of the pancreas. This is where the superior mesenteric artery here arises from the abdominal aorta at the level of L1, the transpyloric plane. It is the same level where the portal vein is formed. The portal vein is formed behind the neck of the pancreas by the union of the splenic vein and the superior mesenteric vein. Note that the splenic vein has a position that is a little below the splenic artery. The splenic vein also receives the inferior mesenteric vein. The superior mesenteric artery is shown here to give rise to its first branch, and that is the inferior pancreatico-duodenal artery. Inferior pancreatico-duodenal, that supplies the head of the pancreas as well as the duodenum. Here is the abdominal aorta, giving rise to the celiac trunk and the superior mesenteric artery. On the right side is the inferior vena cava. The inferior vena cava receives the renal veins. The renal arteries are lateral branches of the abdominal aorta. At the hilum of the kidney, the most anterior structure is the vein, renal vein, then the artery, and then the pelvis of the kidney. Renal vein anteriorly, renal artery behind, and the pelvis of the kidney is the most posteriorly. The suprarenal gland, the left suprarenal gland, is crescentic in shape. This vein is the suprarenal vein, the left suprarenal vein. Note that the left suprarenal vein drains into the left renal vein. The left renal vein is longer than the right renal vein because the inferior vena cava is located to the right side. The right suprarenal gland is pyramidal in shape, and its vein is a short and wide vein that drains directly into the inferior vena cava. This is the level of the bifurcation of the aorta. It is located at the level of L4, where the aorta bifurcates into left and right common iliac arteries. The inferior vena cava is formed more distally at the level of L5 by the union of the left and right common iliac veins. The hilum of the kidney leads into the renal sinus, and the renal sinus contains also some fat, as you can see here. This is the renal pelvis, and you can see that these are the major calyces. 2 to 3 major calyces here. There are 3 major calyces leading into the pelvis. The pelvis will later on give rise to the ureter. Each major calyx receives minor calyces. So these are the minor calyces. This is the cortex of the kidney, renal cortex. And this is the region of the medulla. You can see that most of the medulla is formed of pyramidal-shaped structures called renal pyramids. The renal pyramids project into the minor calyces. The projections are called the renal papilla. Inside the kidney, the distribution of the vessels is shown. This is a segmental vein. Segmental veins will unite to form the renal vein, and they are themselves formed by interlobar veins, arcuate veins. And of course, these are accompanied by arteries. These arteries here that are present in the cortex are called interlobular arteries and arcuate arteries, then interlobar arteries, and then segmental arteries.